going up on a job and I'm doing a light demonstration, I'm looking in all these areas where it's called hardscape. So if there's stone, pavers, concrete, porches, lanais, those are the applications that get the core drill. I'm gonna cover the tools necessary to complete some hardcore drilling. And the first main tool you wanna do to core drill a hole is have a large angle grinder that you put a wet, dry bit on, okay? This is a core bit. For the small mini well, you're gonna use 1.5-inch bit. And these are diamonds on the end of it. Okay, you can look them up online or whatnot. I prefer the wet, dry bit because when it's clogged up with the concrete, you can use a screwdriver to get the bit out, which I'll go over in a second. So this tool is necessary to do your core drills. The other tool needed for the core drills, it's called an angle grinder. An angle grinder is what a lot of tile guys will use to open up the grout line to cut their tiles and whatnot. It comes with a 4.5-inch blade. But I've found if you use a 4.5-inch blade against the house and you're trying to make a cut, you can actually scratch each surface. So I put a 7.5 blade on there and it works great. It's a variable speed. If we're trying to keep our dust down low, not only will we back up the grinder with a vacuum cleaner, but we will actually turn this cutter down very low and just make small cuts at a time. There's another way as well. If you don't want to vacuum up the dust, you can take a wet sponge behind your cutter and it will catch a lot of the dust. When you're cutting and drilling, don't forget the PPE. Here we have the respiratory mask. So if you're doing your cutting, you will protect your lungs. Here you have your goggles. You always want to protect your eyes. And then your ears. These are very important because if you don't protect your ears, you're going to have a lot of problems. When we're installing large wells, we're going to use a 3-inch wet dry bit with the diamonds on the end of it. And it's going to go on your large angle grinder. DeWalt is one of the best companies out there, and I would suggest investing in a good tool. So this right here, this bit is 1.5 for your mini well, which is a small well, or the Predator, which is the same thing except with the lens. And if you're going for the large well application, you want to break out the large bit. Now you can determine if you're going to use a small well, you can determine if you're going to use a larger well, but always do that on the night of the demonstration so when you're selling the project, you know exactly what you're up against and you can price accordingly. So I've already scoped out the job and I realized, I was like, okay, we're going to put our lights here, here, and here, and I'll pre-mark these lights. In most applications, you have the pavers or the stone or the tile, concrete, whatnot, existing, so it's good to look at the entire job and determine on what the best measurement away from the wall would be to make all the mini wells or large wells. So once you come up with that measurement, you keep it consistent running across the entire home. My sweet spot is anywhere from 1/2 foot to 1 foot, depending on how subtle or strong you want the light. If you core drill it closer to the wall, it's gonna be a little bit brighter at the bottom and softer at the top. If you back it off a little bit, it's gonna be softer all the way up, which is one of my looks. I'd much rather have a softer finish. I've done demonstrations and the stucco or whatnot might not be the best job, so you're better off showing the homeowner their house lit up with the lights backed off a little bit instead of trying to blast it up against it. Okay, so my template, a template's crucial. You can make a template for a small bit, you can make it for the large bit. And what I use is cardboard. I just fold it up and tape it off. You can use a piece of wood if you want. I found the wood makes the bit bind a little bit more, so I use something that's a little bit lighter and easier to pick up. So once you make your template, you will drill this out into the dirt instead of trying to make your template on the surface. I will line it up exactly where I'm supposed to be. Okay, and once it's lined up, I'll put my foot on it so it doesn't move around before drilling. And then when I'm drilling, I'm wallering, so I'm making clockwise circles. I'm making circular motions with this drill bit to allow this core to be smaller than the bit itself. So when we go to clean it out, it's a lot easier for you. And when you start your core drill, you're wallering, you're doing the cut. We're gonna go over this more in a second. But it's very important to go ahead and practice using the tools as much as you can before entering the job, okay? So if this line wasn't here, this grout line, we're gonna visualize it's not there, and then we're gonna make sure it's there to get our wire there as we're cutting. We're backing it up with a vacuum cleaner to eliminate the dust for the homeowner. and we're gonna get our line to the hole that we just drilled so we can power up the light. But practice is key. Always get plenty of practice on your belt so when you get on the job, you're ready to rock. Okay, we're doing more core drills, and it's very important that you know when you're gonna do some hardscape lighting, which is in stone, travertine, pavers, concrete, whatnot, there's gonna be many variables. So you always wanna scope out the job and get a good game plan before you start doing your layout, your drilling, and your cutting. So here we have a concrete slab. We've already predetermined that the homeowner wanted these fixtures 3 foot apart, so I did my measurement. Now I'm coming in, I take my template, I'm gonna put my PP on, protection, and I'm gonna core drill this hole for the light. So here we core drilled our hole. We took the angle grinder to cut for the wire. On this application, it's nice that it's only a couple inches from where the light goes. So we're actually gonna use the wire from the fixture itself. In most cases, this hole might be in the middle of the driveway, in the middle of a lanai, to where you're feeding the area with existing wire coming up to the hole itself. All the wire, the light would then go inside the hole. So in most cases, you would have your existing wire coming up to the fixture itself with the wire coming out. And when you connect your mini well, all the wiring goes inside the same hole. If you're on the edge like this, like using the Predator, if this was the edge of the driveway, you could actually feed all your lights on the edge by a 12-2 that's running along the side, running parallel with it, which is nice. So to get a 20-year warranty on this system, you must use a transformer that has the surge protecting system in it. You wanna use the corrosion-free wire, and the drums are crucial when you're connecting your fixtures. If you're using a low-end connector, then the water is gonna actually wick through the fixture itself and make its way towards the driver, which will damage the fixture. So it's a combination of using the right transformer, the better corrosion-free wire, the good connectors. On the mini wells, I'll use the small dry cons. They have the silicone in there that will keep the fixture from wicking the moisture. They have the larger connects. And then we have the larger drum that has a crimping system to it. But using a better connector is definitely going to keep that 20-year warranty in alignment. So we're going to twist the wires together. And you can see we have corrosion-free wire, which is it's silver, so it's actually tinned. And tinned is actually a copper wire that has a coating of it to protect the copper. Copper wire will actually tarnish over time. The more the copper tarnishes, it starts turning black, and then your voltage will slowly drop year after year. So the tinned wire is the way to go. Here's the process of installing a drum. We have the wire coming from your transformer, and we have the light wire. So we cut the tinned part of each wire off flat. We feed it through the large cylinder first, through the flanges, the bottom of the flanges. Have the wire come out towards the top. Sometimes it's not even. It's gonna be easier for you if you cut them both even, like so. Then you do your splicing of the wires, okay? You splice your wires, you twist them together, and they give you a ring. You have little brass rings that you put around it. So you take your brass ring, you put around the wires itself, you take your crimpers, you crimp down on the ring, making it tight against the wires. Then you fold over the excess so it locks in, like so. Once you have that, you want to feed it back into the large piece, and you're going to get this. When you get this, it means I should have cut maybe a little bit extra off that one wire to be able to snap this in. Otherwise, it's going to be a bear to try to get it all in. So it takes practice like anything else. So we're gonna start over with the ring. We're gonna cut it flat. We're gonna splice. And they make special crimpers for this. Right now I'm just using a splicer. So you feed your ring, large portion first. Squeeze the ring over the wiring, like so. Fold the excess over, pull the wire back down into the drum before you feed the gel cap on top. You're gonna hear it click, and you're done. So then now that I'm connected, I like using a larger screwdriver and kind of gently pushing the wire down in there to manipulate it. This is the part that you want to use some patience, because sometimes it takes a little time. So once you get your wire in there, you'll actually silicone around the bottom of this flange to keep it in place. And it's a beautiful finish. I actually, on my light demonstrations, I always have a large well, a mini well, different fixtures to actually show the client what they're actually getting. Now we're gonna mud this joint in. We're gonna make it go away. You see I have the gloves. This mortar has lime in it, the marble dust. It will burn your skin. So using a 6-inch dry knife, a drywall pan, you can use a hawk and a trowel if you feel more comfortable. You put your mud on the joint. And this is the finished process. We're trying to hide where the wire was. So this typically would be a sponge that I wrung out with some water. And we're gonna go over this area that we just mudded to try to smooth our edges. And we're gonna make that wiring go away. There it is, a clean finish. Wipe the fixture, set it down. You can even take a silicone and kind of make it stick more. But now that we've hit our wire, we're at the finishing process and we're ready to move on to the next fixture. Okay, now we just finished up the application of a core drill. We put our wire in there, fed our light. We did some mud work over the top of it. And that's how you do the core drills in the hardscape, you know? And it all just differentiates from job to job. There's all these variables between the job site being different, whether it's pavers, stone, concrete. You have different personalities you're working with. It takes a lot of hands-on, you know, and the more you do this, the more confident you're gonna get, and the more excited you're gonna be about it, because we're doing something that most people aren't doing, and that's what you want. You wanna differentiate yourself from other companies, and you wanna prove the value to your consumer, and that's what I do on a daily basis, and I wish you the best of luck. So good luck with all your core drilling events. Garden Light LED is the only company that I would install through, and I wish the best of luck to you. And I remember, there's all the variables with Garden Light. They're here to help you, and we'll run you through the process if you need any more information about what we're doing. Garden Light LED in Tampa is the only fixture you should be installing.